Very often I raise up this question with groups of people who are willing to introspect and think, is it better to love or is it better to be loved? Many of us have never actually given a thought to such a simple aspect of our life. And when we do introspect and then we do ask this question, we make certain statements without it realizing the depth of what it is all about. Why I'm asking you this is, this plays a very important role to today's topic, which is, why do we have such a strong need to belong? So is it that I want to love people, I want to have that positive feelings and that warmth and love and caring in my heart so that I can connect to people and feel happy? Or do I crave that people should love me, people should accept me, people should make me part of their group? It starts with that, and that is how we move on to thinking about a lot of things. Let's start off with this quick understanding that when we are small, it is drilled into us that we have to belong. It is told to us that this is your amma, appa, this is family, you belong here. We are doing it with good intentions. We want the child to feel that emotional security that yes, I have people to take care of me, I belong to my parents, my family. But the effect in many, many cases is overdone. I start connecting so deeply that I cannot do without that connection to whatever I belong to, starting, as I said, with family. But it doesn't even stop with the family. It goes on to the clan, it goes on to the caste, it goes on to community, it goes on to village or whichever place you're living in, it goes on to your state, it goes on to your country. Everywhere there's this concept that I have to belong, I have to have this identity. And that is the reason why you will find people, you know, over and above. One is, of course, a lot of people want to have that sense of belonging with regard to even their job. That, you know, I work for such and such prestigious organization, or I am holding this position in this, so I belong there, or I have my own business or my own respectability that happens. But it doesn't stop with that. Have you noticed how many people, for example, go out of the way to get a membership of a club or to contest for becoming a committee member of that club? It almost looks as though their livelihood depends on that, the effort, the time, the energy that they spend, because they want to make sure that my identity is with, I am the joint secretary of this club or this association or whatever, including sports. I'm playing games, I'm enjoying the sport, but no, I want to belong to a club, I want to be an office bearer, I want to be accepted by them. So things go to such an extent that very often it is drilled into us that unless I belong to ABCD, I am an incomplete person. Then of course we move on to the peer age, as we call it, teenage, we say is peer age. There again, there's a reason for it. It starts with the fact that as we are growing up, somehow the impression given to us is that if you study well, then your parents love you. If you get good marks, then only you have a status and then only you are recognized as somebody. That may not be true. As a parent, I may love my child unconditionally, but the way I'm interacting with my child, I'm giving out the message. Whenever you do well, I'm so happy with my child, I praise him, I tell everybody else, see my child passed his exam, got so many marks and all. When the child is not doing well, I sort of, you know, become very dull, I'm not really happy, I don't behave in the same manner with my child. So the child grows up thinking that I do not get unconditional love from my parents. And therefore, when the child grows into adolescence and when he seems to find friends who are willing to give that unconditional love, anything happening, he is standing on the road and somebody comes and says something, his friend will say, hey, how dare you talk like that to my friend? He's willing to beat up and get beaten up for his sake. He'll say, ah, see how much he cares for me. He gives me this unconditional love. So what happens is, we move over to what we call as the peer rush age. I have to belong to this gang or this group or this batch or whatever. It becomes extremely important to us. I was just thinking of a simple example I had read the other day. You pick up, let's say, a puppy from somewhere and bring him home. You play with him, you feed him, you do whatever it is, he's scampering around. You're even busy doing something else and the puppy is running around. Somewhere comes, looks at you again, goes off. The whole day goes past. In the night, you have fed him, you've taken care of him, all his needs are taken care of. And you make a nice warm bed for him and you put him in that bed, switch off the light and come back to sleep. Within minutes, he starts whining. He'll start getting so insecure, he'll start whining, yelping, screaming. All you have to do is go and pick him up and bring him and put him in your bed. And he happily goes off to sleep. You are not taking care of him. You have turned around and you have gone off to sleep. But now he knows that he belongs. That few minutes when you had left him alone with all the comforts, you've given him milk, you've given him everything that he wants, but he gets a feeling that there's nobody to care for me, I'm alone. And using that as an example to show you how life begins in that sort of in a stage and how it grows up. And you know how a pet dog is, for example, you know. You keep him the whole day alone in the house, but when you come back, he is so happy, he is so thrilled, he's jumping all over you. Why? Because he knows that he belongs to you and you belong to him, even though you have left him away. And incidentally, this is so different from human beings. You leave some family member alone for the whole day and you come back, you don't get that love and care and jumping and hugging that the pet gives you. But that's a different thing. We'll talk about that later. What I'm emphasizing upon is that the way human beings are built and the way our upbringing is and our metabolism is, it is not enough just to say that, yes, I have family members, I have friends, I have classmates, I have neighbors, I have colleagues, and I have a fairly good relationship with most of them. So I should be happy. It doesn't stop with that. There is a strong need that I have to belong to something. In every sphere you will see that. In politics, you have to be a follower of one particular party. You cannot say that I like party A, and I'm also fairly happy with party B, and I think party C is also doing some good things. Nobody will tolerate that. They will go on and on and on emphasizing that, do you care for us? Are you part of this party? How dare you speak in praise of the other person? It happens even in the media, you must have seen, if a politician of one party praises some good work done by the other party, there's a big hue and cry as though, you know, somebody has done a good thing, so he's just talking about it and praising it. But he's not allowed to do that. In fact, some of the superpowers have gone to the extent of, you know, when they start interfering in the smaller countries' affairs, there are these neutral countries who say, we don't care, we have nothing to do, we are running our own country, our people are there. We don't know what's happening, we don't want to interfere. But the superpower starts, you know, twisting them by saying, are you on their side or are you on our side? With the underlying statement, if you are not with us, you are against us. That's a message given out. So you have to say that, yes, we are with you. I'm just giving these as examples in every field. I told you, even, for example, a religious guru or somebody, he wants 100% loyalty. You cannot say that today I will attend your discourse, tomorrow I will attend Guru B and then Guru C and Guru D. They don't tolerate that. You have to give yourself that unconditional surrender. In every sphere that happens, sports club, you can't say that I'll be a member of three clubs and I'll practice here and I'll play there and I'll represent they don't like those sort of things. You have to be, you know, part and parcel of this thing. Similarly, the jealousy factor that comes in, that, you know, you should not dilute your attention, your affection, your love to anybody else. I want to have 100% possession of this person. So we don't even realize the extent to which these things go and how we keep getting into these things. There is also, many of you may be aware, 100 years back this great psychologist called Maslow came out with the hierarchy of needs, what human beings need basically. So as you are aware, it starts with the basic needs, food, clothing, shelter, the basic needs, you know. If I am hungry, I can't see beyond my hunger. If I don't have a place to stay, that will be my priority, I can't think of anything else, that sort of, you know, things happen. So I am looking for that basic needs. Once my basic needs are met, then what do I move on to? I move on to the security needs. I live in a rented house, I want a house of my own. I have a temporary job, I want a permanent job. So everywhere now I am looking. I have a good salary, but I want to have some savings so that in case I lose my job or in case I fall sick, I should have something to back up with. So we reach that level. Once I have fulfilled my security needs, then according to Maslow, we move into the need of love and belonging. He has identified it so beautifully that we all have this need of, he didn't stop with love. Need for love is one thing, but need for not just love, but belonging love. That you have to belong to me. I have to belong to you. There has to be that. And that leads to so much of insecurity. In fact, the more you doubt yourself, the greater is your need for self-esteem, self-worth. The greater is the craving to belong. So whenever I find myself that I am craving to belong, I am saying, no, I want to possess, be it my own spouse, my child, my subordinates in office, people of my community, whoever it may be, it doesn't matter. It could be even be a pet. But when I have this strong need to belong, it is a very clear indicator that there is something wrong with me. So it is nothing to do with the, you know, relationships. It is to do with my own needs and wants. Remember that also. A lot of this craving for belonging is not because of needs, it is because of wants. My needs are being fulfilled. Whoever is my friend, my spouse, my loved one, my community, whatever it is, they are giving me everything that I want. So my needs are being fulfilled. But I want to feel that extra thing. I mentioned to you, I want to become a member of a club in my area, which just gives me a lot of satisfaction. Yes, that was a need, that I need to have a place where I can go chill out in the evenings, have some snacks, play some. Yes, I could define that as a need. But I want to become an office bearer of that club. I want to fight elections in that club. That's not a need, that is a want. So I want us to be very clear on one factor, that is, differentiate between needs and wants. If your needs are not being fulfilled, work on fulfilling them. But if it is something to do with your wants, please become aware that only because of your wants, you are clinging on to somebody, you are becoming dependent, your need for belonging is becoming stronger and stronger, and however good you are to people, however much you may have loved ones surrounding you, there will inevitably be moments when people will let you down. they will not give you the extent and the level of security and belonging which you want. And that is the time when we get absolutely pulled down, we get shattered, people go into depression, people become lonely. So many things happen. Because while things were not really going bad, we didn't take the trouble of finding out that I have to work on it. I am moving more and more towards this craving for belonging. If I overcome that, life becomes beautiful.